Welcome to the worship service of the First Baptist Church of Marion, Illinois. Located just two blocks west of Tower Square near downtown Marion, this vibrant and energetic church meets weekly for high-energy, Christ-centered services. Enjoy the warm fellowship of the First Baptist family. We pray God's Spirit will be evident in our service and that you will want to come and see what First Baptist of Marion is all about.
Don't come hanging around my door. You know you can't control me, 'cause I don't serve you anymore. Well, you have to flee when I'm on my knees. It's where I'm gonna stay. I'm warning you, your days are through. You better hear me when I say, step back, get behind me. I'm not the least bit afraid of you. I'm a child of God Almighty. There ain't nothing He can do. When I call on Him, He rushes in. He's just one word away. I think it's fair to warn you, you don't even want to make me pray. When worry weighs down on me and starts messing with my mind, when fear and doubt comes calling, saying it's all a waste of time, well, I recognize you're accusing lies. You must not have a clue. Oh, you've seen it before, and I'll tell you what's more, what the power of prayer can do. Step back, get behind me. I'm not the least bit afraid of you. Child of God Almighty, there ain't nothing He can't do. When I call on Him, He rushes in. He's just one word away. I think it's fair to tell you, you don't even want to make me pray. Oh, step back, get behind me. I'm not the least bit afraid of you. I'm a child of God Almighty. There ain't nothing He can do. When I call on Him, He rushes in. He's just one word away. I think it's fair to warn you, you don't even want to make me pray. When I call on Him, He rushes in. He's just one word away. I think it's fair to warn you, you don't even want to make me pray. Well, I think it's fair to warn you, you don't even want to make me pray.
She's one of my favorite singers. Let's pray together. Father, thank you. Thank you for allowing us the privilege of communicating with you through prayer. Lord, you've taught us to submit ourselves unto God, resist the devil, and he will flee from us. And we pray, Father, that today that's exactly how it will be. As we humble ourselves, we submit ourselves to you, preparing for worship, resisting all of the distractions, resisting all the things that the devil might whisper in our ears when we've come here to worship. So I pray, Father, as we submit to you and resist the devil, that he will flee from this place and we will hear from you, we will worship you in spirit and truth, and may your name be glorified. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, hallelujah. God bless y'all. Thank you for coming today. Let's all stand. We're going to do a little welcoming here for our guests and for regular attenders. We're going to tell everybody, welcome to First Baptist Church, Marion, Illinois.
Sing with us. That's why.
Thank you. change, plans fail, and you look for love on a grander scale. Storms rise, hopes fade, and you lose your bets on another day. Just not sure enough, Jesus will still be there. His love will never change, sure as the steady rain. Jesus will still be there. No one else is true, he'll still be
Thank you, Lisa. Jesus will still be there. Lo, I will be with you always, even to the ends of the earth. Y'all may be wondering why I have a pitcher of water. Especially, I like what one person in the congregation said one time, says, I don't know why you have water out there. I've never seen a windmill that ran off of water. I prayed for him. Today, as you take a look at the title of what we're going to be talking about, have you ever wondered how we are to know what to say, especially when we're speaking about spiritual things? I was reading this week about a young salesman. My dad was a car dealer for 42 years, so I grew up around the car business all of my growing up years. And this young salesman, he was just lamenting the fact that he just missed a big sale. There was a couple there looking at a car, and he was just so upset. But he told his manager, as he was sharing with his sales manager, "Well, I guess it just proves you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink." And the sales manager put his arm on his shoulder and said, "Son, take my advice. Your job is not to make them drink. Your job is to make them thirsty." Have you ever wondered why, when you go to the movies and they got that big screen? I mean, we don't have big screens like the movies do. The movies have these big, big screens. And all of a sudden, right at the opportune time, all you can see is a glass of ice, and they pour some kind of soda in it. And the interesting thing is, you can't hear what that just sounded like, but with the cinematic sound that they have, all you can hear is, and you get thirsty. And you want to go to the place where they sell this soda. And if for some reason the sound and the sight of that doesn't get you, they have written above it, "refreshing," to put that word in your mind too. You see, that's the way it is with telling others about Jesus Christ, our source of hope. Our lives should be so filled with Christ that it creates a thirst for the gospel. 1 Peter 3:15 says, "But in your hearts, regard Christ the Lord as holy, ready at any time to give a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you." Jesus said, "Let your light so shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven," Matthew 5:16. In such a way, Jesus was talking about the fact that we need to seek God's help to present the gospel in a way that they will be able to hear the truth without resisting. In other words, God uses you to make them thirsty. I've trained a lot of people in a lot of different ways of how to share the gospel. I remember back in the late 80s and early 90s, we did something, and everything was acronyms. Everything is acronyms, you know. We taught them how to do CWT. How many of y'all remember that? Robin does. Yeah. It meant continuous witness training. That's what it stood for, okay? And as we were teaching, we had to teach them over several weeks because you had to memorize about 8 to 9 pages, 8.5 by 11, double-spaced pages, in this presentation. Guess how many takers we had for that one? There was a few with photographic memories that thought it was the greatest thing in the world, but one of the problems we had is they were so interested or so nervous about getting all the words out that they didn't really, in a way that made people thirsty, share the gospel. But I will say this, it was better than not sharing the gospel at all. It's like one woman said to one of the great evangelists, said, "Man, I don't like the way you share the gospel." He said, "That's okay, but it's better than your way of not sharing the gospel." I remember we did something called FAITH, F-A-I-T-H. F stood for forgiveness. A stands for available. Forgiveness is needed and forgiveness is available. And then impossible. It's impossible for God to allow anyone into heaven because he is holy and just if they have not had their sins taken care of. And then T stood for turn, and then H stood for heaven. And so we did that F-A-I-T-H, and we memorized about 4 pages with that one, 4 or 5 pages. And again, it was not a bad way of doing it. I mean, we had results from it, but not everybody could do it. Not everybody had photographic memories. But it was better than not sharing the gospel at all. That's why I'm so excited today to be able to share with you from God's Word what the Holy Spirit used Paul to say in our passage today. There is a better way, and it doesn't have to be that difficult. Charles Stanley said this, "God's plan for enlarging his kingdom is so simple, one person telling another about the Savior. Yet we're busy and full of excuses. Just remember, someone's eternal destiny is at stake. The joy you'll have when you meet that person in heaven will far exceed any momentary discomfort you felt in sharing the gospel here. Now, I will say this, that there's varying gifts and varying ways that we can share the gospel, but I will tell you this, there is not a one of us in here that cannot share good news. I mean, you have a new grandkid, you are up on your podium telling everybody that you know, I had a new grandkid. Or if you graduate, or if you get married, you know, you want to tell it. You can tell good news. But first, it has to be good news to you. It has to be good news. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians 2, verses 1 through 5, because we're going to answer the question today, how do we know what to say when we speak, especially about spiritual things? And here is the answer we're going to find in Scripture. We agree with Jesus to allow a demonstration of the Spirit's power through us. Beginning with verse 1 of 1 Corinthians 2. And I, brethren, when I came to you, did not come with excellence of speech or of wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. I was with you in weakness, in fear, and in much trembling. Let me pause there a minute. You don't think of the Apostle Paul coming like that. Don't you realize that whenever God calls us to do something important, yes, we're going to be nervous. Yes, we're going to have fear and trembling. But even the Apostle Paul said that. But listen to what the answer here is. And my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but, here we go, in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not be in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Let's pray together. Father, I come to you today not having anything of myself to share. But I pray, Father, that you will use your messenger today as a demonstration of your power, of your truth, of, Father, what you want to be impressed upon their hearts and minds, whether they're here in this building or whether they're watching by television or YouTube or any other way that they may see and hear what we're talking about today. Father, I know that you're going to be speaking to a wide array of people, but especially those who do not know you and do not know for sure today that they're going to heaven if they were to die. Lord Jesus, I praise God that as I did the funeral yesterday of Don Hennard, I knew that he was in heaven. But Father, I don't know that about everybody. You do. And my prayer is today, if there's anybody here as we talk about the gospel today that doesn't know you, that you would call them to yourself in a demonstration of your power and save them and let them come to know you today. And Father, for those of us that are Christians, inspire us, encourage us, and challenge us to know what to say whenever we speak about spiritual things. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Well, let's begin by going back to the Scriptures and taking a look at kind of what Paul was saying to us. Of course, the Holy Spirit spoke through Paul. So look at verse 1 with me again. Paul's practice was not to depend on his own persuasive words or wisdom. Verse 1, notice what he said. He said, when I came to you, I didn't come with excellence of speech or of wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God. You know, I heard someone say one time, if I rely on my ability to talk someone into being saved, then the devil, who's better at this, will talk them into staying lost. That's not the goal, to talk somebody into something. Paul had the education. He had the speaking skills to present the arguments and logical dissertations that the Greeks loved to engage in. But Paul chose another way. A way that all of us can rely on to accomplish God's will as we make it a priority in our lives to tell others the way to Jesus. Someone wrote, we are to live in such a way that those who know you but don't know God will come to know God because they know you. That is a process of reflecting Jesus Christ to the world. Paul wanted the message to be clear and of God. So his practice, as he went to talk to the people of Corinth, he wanted them not to be bowled over by his oratory skills. He wanted the message to be very clear, to demonstrate not his own abilities, but to demonstrate the power of God. And so we see the point that he presented. Paul's point was focused on Jesus Christ and him crucified. He says that in verse 2. Now, I don't think this text is telling us that God will always limit our message to just this, but the point of being on mission for Jesus Christ is to share the gospel. Romans 1:16 says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes." Folks, we need to take that scripture to heart. When you feel powerless, when you fear fearful, when you are overcome with, "Oh, I don't know what to do or say," listen, "I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes." If you believe in Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and Savior, you will be saved. And someday, when if I'm still around and I'm doing your funeral, I can say by their life and by their own confession, they were a Christian. And Jesus promises, "Whosoever calleth upon the name of the Lord will be saved." And then you will know that you know that you know. So Paul's point was focused on Jesus Christ and him crucified. Matt Chandler was talking about relational evangelism. And what that is where you just kind of go and hang around people. But, you know, sometimes they become friends, but you never really get to the gospel. Here's what he said about that. He said, "Relational evangelism, go for it as long as it turns into real evangelism. You hanging out with your buddy so he can see Christians are cool is not what we are called to do. You're eventually going to have to open up your mouth and share the gospel. When the pure gospel is shared, people respond. At the heart of everything we do, hopefully at this church, there is some aspect of trying to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. When people come into my office and say, "You know, Pastor, we ought to do this and this," my question will always be to them, "How will that help us do what Jesus called us to do?" What did he call us to do? Matthew 28:19-20. "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I've commanded you. And lo," that's what Lisa's song was about, "and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." When you are on mission for Jesus Christ, he says, "I'm going to be in on that with you." Acts 1:8 says, "But you shall receive power." Power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses to me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the end of the earth. You have been promised. While you are on mission for God, you have the power of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit working with you. You have the message of Jesus, you have the presence of Jesus, and you have the power of the Holy Spirit speaking to you. And so what the scriptures and what Paul is sharing with us today is that we need to keep the main thing. Okay? Used to have a sign in my office that said that, where I would read it every day. The main thing is to keep the main thing. And the main thing is that people are lost and going to hell without Jesus. So they get the right to choose whether they accept or not. But I don't want them in any way, form, or fashion to ever be able to say that I didn't try to stand between them and hell, telling them that there's a way out of this, to get them off that path. When we're trying to decide what to say, when we speak, we should always be ready to share the gospel when prompted by the Holy Spirit. And you may be thinking, "Well, this isn't a message for me because I don't know how to share the gospel." Well, I'm not trying to lay a guilt trip on you, but I will say this. That is your Lord's mission. To get saved, one of the things we have to do is say, if you confess with your mouth, "Jesus is Lord." Whenever Jesus is Lord, then his mission becomes our mission. And his mission was to seek and save those who are lost. So we are to seek and tell them about Jesus so that he can save them. So the way you begin is very simple. I'm going to give you a way to access the Holy Spirit that would allow you to tell anybody the gospel. First step, you need to be saved yourself. You really do. You need to know that you 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 are saved. None of this maybe so stuff. If all you got's maybe so stuff, then you come talk to me so I can share with you in a one-on-one talk about how you can know that you know that you know that you know that you're saved. So first thing is, you need to be saved. And if you are saved, then you start by telling them, what was your life like before receiving Christ? And then secondly, say what were the circumstances surrounding how you came to know Christ. Very simply, I was saved at a youth revival at the First Baptist Church of Ullin when I was 13 years old. The preacher was preaching something, but God was calling me to be saved. I'd been in Sunday school all my life, but I had never acknowledged Him as my Lord and Savior. I had never asked Him to save me other than just privately, which is okay, but God was calling me to make my statement public. And so that was the circumstances surrounding it. And I went up to the altar, and while I was at the altar, a deacon by the name of Chuck Miller shared with me how to be saved. And then, and back to our outline, then you talk to them very briefly about how your life has been after receiving Christ. And then you ask them if they would like to receive Christ. And so to ask them if they'd like to receive Christ, you need to know how to share the gospel. The Bible says you receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you to be witnesses. If you can't witness, then my question for you is the Holy Spirit inside of you? Okay? The Holy Spirit inside of you is the power to tell people what happened to you. And all of us can tell good news of something that's happened to us in that very, that's a simple little way. What was my life like before? How did I come to, what happened to make me decide to receive Jesus? And what's my life been like afterwards? But when you ask them how to be saved, then you need to share the basics of the gospel. It's not that hard, folks. God sent His Son Jesus to this world to be a model for us and to show us in the flesh who and what God is and what He stands for. He came to this earth. He lived a perfect life. He died on the cross for our sins. He was placed in a tomb. He rose from the dead, which proved beyond a shadow of a doubt two things. One, that everything He said was the truth. And number two, He is the living Son of God. So if you know that, and you know John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And if you really want to get, you know, have a little more to that, verse 17 said, for God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. So you tell them, here's what happened to me. First, I admitted to God that I was a sinner. And I repented, and I learned later what this word repent means. It means to change my mind and come into agreement with God about sin and His remedy for sin. And that was Jesus. Jesus is the remedy for sin. And so we tell Jesus that we believe in Him. For God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him, whosoever believeth in Him, what do you believe in? That He died on the cross for our sins, that He was placed in a tomb, and that He rose from the dead, and He is the living Son of God. So you say, I'm sorry for my sins. Please forgive me of my sins. And then you say, I believe in You, Jesus. I'm not giving you a magic formula here. I'm just telling you that's the things you have to believe. There are no magic formula prayers that, oh, if I do these words and don't leave out any of these and ands, I'll be saved. It's not that at all. But you do have to admit you're a sinner and ask forgiveness for your sins. Number two, you do have to believe in Jesus, what He came here to do and who He was, and that He rose from the dead. And then number three, the Bible says in Romans 10 and verse 9, if you confess with your mouth, y'all know what a mouth is, right? Okay. The word confess is that you are in agreement with Him about what you're getting ready to say. This is true to me. I am sharing with you, I am telling you a truth. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart God raised Him from the dead, you shall be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness. That sins are forgiven, you are right with God, and you would get to go to heaven because of what Jesus did on the cross. So you see, one believes with the heart, one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth, one confesses unto, confession is made unto salvation. Folks, that's it. And then Romans 10:13 says, whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, I know some of you are thinking, Bob, you say that every Sunday. Every Sunday you say that. You know why? Number one, People are dying and going to hell. Number two, to teach you how to do it. You already know more than you think. You do. Because you've heard it every week. 10.5 years I've been here. And somewhere along the line, I say that. So that you will know. So when you come to me and say, I don't know how to share the gospel, if you've just been paying a little bit of attention, I will send you the notes for today's sermon. You can have it in your little fist and you can look at it. And there's, of course, there's other techniques and other things that you can learn, and I'd be happy to spend time with you. But let me just say to you, Paul's point was focused on Jesus Christ and him crucified because that's the only way to get to heaven. Jesus said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man, nobody comes unto me except, comes to the Father except through me. No one. So that's why. But now, here's even the best part. Oh, golly, this is good. This is so good. You don't even have to do it by yourself. Listen to what Paul said. And my speech and my, oh, verses 4 and 5. 1 Corinthians 2:4-5. And my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of the power, that your faith should not be in wisdom of men, but in the power of God. That's where the power comes from. You're saying, well, I don't feel the power of God. Start witnessing. The Holy Spirit of God will flow through you and you'll go, Shazam! Golly! Hallelujah! I was watching Billy Graham yesterday and lost my mic there. I got a little excited. I want you to be excited as well. But I was watching Billy Graham and I was listening to what Billy Graham was preaching. You know what he was preaching? This! Amen. This! And people were getting saved. And that's my prayer. People will get saved. But demonstration of the power. The fact that I can share the gospel with you is a demonstration of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit's power coming through me. Many people are fearful to talk about the gospel because they're afraid, since they haven't got the Bible memorized from flaps to maps, that they can't do it. No, it's not the way it works at all. When you're willing to share your testimony and you're willing to learn how to share the gospel, you are going to have more opportunities to do it than I will ever have. I spend a lot of my time working with church people and ministering them because I'm a shepherd of a flock that's already here. I do that. I have to go out of my way to get to the people that you are with every single day. And if you would just sit there and listen, you would have opportunities to share the gospel. You may be thinking, well, Bob, you know, I'm kind of scared to do that. Well, is your faith in fear or is your faith in Jesus? Let's just put it out there on the table. Is your faith in I can't, or is your faith in God can? See, that's the difference. That's the difference. Our willingness to talk about Jesus should be based on what we believe Jesus wants to do through us. Not what we can or can't do. You know, I don't know if God talks to the angels like you hear jokes and stuff every once in a while. But I could just imagine, if that does happen, I could just see Michael and Gabriel, the archangels, hanging out with God one day. And God said, you see that little kid there, Bobby? Lives in Ullin. You see that little kid there? Someday he's going to preach the gospel. And I can hear Michael say, what? Him? Lord! Do you remember that he didn't even go on field trips in his first and second grade year because he was so scared he would sign out of school sick because he was afraid to go on a field trip? And you're going to put him up in front of people? God, we know you don't make mistakes, but this may be your first. And then the Lord, who knows all things, he knows the beginning and the end, may look at Michael and Gabriel and say, you know, someday Bobby's going to lead a church. And I'm going to make him stand up in front of cameras that are going to be broadcast all over the place. I'm going to put him on YouTube. So people in New Mexico, who we have heard from in the mail, people in New Mexico will be watching him. And they go, are you sure about this, Lord? There is no way that could happen. No way. God looks at him. You know, God's so loving. He goes, he may say something like, yes, way, my dear messengers. Because I am the way, he will do it. It will not depend on his courage. It will not depend on his abilities. It will not depend on his wisdom. It will be a demonstration of my power. And if he is willing, I am able to do powerful things through little Bobby. You just wait and see. Now, I'm not saying that I'm the greatest thing that ever came, the greatest preacher that ever was, but I'll tell you what, the greatest God that ever was preaches through me every week. And that's how I do it. And that's how you'll do it if you just agree and are willing to do it. Paul was a brilliant scholar. Paul could have, man, I mean, he could talk his way out of about anything. But he said, no, that's not the way I'm going to do it. So he began to speak, Jesus and him crucified. And he said, rather than me trying to persuade them, I am going to become a demonstration of the power of God and let him take care of it. So what's the application for us today? We're back to the question, what is God's design for knowing what to say when we speak to others about spiritual things and talk about Jesus? Well, number one, don't think that you have to have a polished presentation of oratory eloquence to pontificate the gospel message to the Homo sapiens inhabiting the earth. In other words, kiss. Keep it simple. Somehow. That's the way you say it, right? Okay. Keep it simple somehow. Using big words or memorizing theological presentation is not required. You know, from listening to me preach over the years, you probably have gathered that I love my wife. And that is true. I love her. But, you know, I don't love her just because I'm supposed to. That's what my kid used to say. I'd say, now, you know why you're supposed to do that? Because I'm supposed to. No, it's not like that. I love her because I want to. And I get to, because it's a privilege she has allowed me to do. You know, amen. If you were to come up to me and be crazy enough to ask the question, how did you and Robin get together? Then you better about have about an hour and a half for me to tell you how the good news of how I met her, how we came to be in relationship with each other, and how life journeying through life has been with her. I mean, I could tell you some stories and you would just enjoy it so much, I'm sure. But you've probably also gathered that I love Jesus. Not because I'm supposed to, but because I want to and because I get to. He gave me the privilege of loving him, loving me first so I could love him back. So if you were going to ask me about Jesus, I don't want to have a problem telling people how I met him, how I came into relationship with him, and what my life has been like since coming into relationship with him. That's how I want to be. It's good to know Scripture. It's good to be able to tell people how to be saved. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. In other words, learn Scripture to know God's way so you can share it with other people. Well, Bob, I can't remember all that stuff. Well, you remember Social Security numbers, and you remember phone numbers. Well, you used to remember phone numbers, and you know your address. All them passwords to all the things that are password protected. I mean, you know all that stuff, and you've memorized all that stuff. I'm pretty sure you can memorize John 3:16 if you have not already. Just use it. Use it. That's how we are saved. God calls us to know what the gospel is, how Jesus came into our lives, and be able and willing to tell others how they can as well. I'm going to give you an example. I'm going to set this up for you. Two guys. One is JJ, and one is Larry. JJ and Larry. I made these people up, okay? So if this resembles you in any way, form, or fashion, no, it's not you. JJ and Larry are made-up characters. Here's the situation. Larry is in his pickup truck and he's going by, I'm sorry, JJ's in his pickup truck and he's going by to pick up Larry, and they're going to a work site. As Larry gets in the truck, JJ says, hey, Larry, you look a little down today. What's going on with you? Well, my wife and I had another fight last night, and we didn't even speak this morning before I left. I don't know, JJ, I've never wanted it, but I've been thinking about divorce lately. I'm sorry to hear that, Larry, JJ said. I know there have been times in my marriage when I wondered if my wife and I were going to make it, but I'll tell you what we did if you want to hear it. He said, I'm open to anything if it worked for you, because you know what? I still love her, but just don't seem like we can agree on anything anymore. I know the feeling, buddy, JJ said. But here's what we did. We knew that trying to solve things on our own wasn't working, so we decided to seek help from God. We learned that God has a design for everything in life, and if we deviate from God's design, it leads to brokenness, which sort of sounds like where you and the missus are right now. Would I be right about that? Yes, that describes us. We're broken. Well, here's what we did. We decided to find out what God's design for marriage was. We both believed God created us, and we both believe that God has a design for everything. So we agreed that we would come together and that we would agree with God about everything. And if we agreed with God about everything, then we'd automatically agree with each other. And we started practicing that. We decided that we had to base our marriage on doing things God's way instead of our way. And we both asked God to forgive us for what we had done. That was the first thing we'd agreed on for some time. Our marriage began to recover as we together pursued God's design. Does that make sense to you, Larry? I'm not very religious, JJ. I don't know much about God's design about anything. And JJ said, well, let me tell you how I became a believer in Jesus Christ, and maybe you'll see something that will help you. Here's how it all started for me. And JJ shared what his life was like before coming to know Jesus. JJ shared the circumstances about surrounding how he prayed to receive Christ into his life. JJ shared what his life had been like since coming to know Jesus. And then JJ looked at his friend Larry after he pulled over. Larry, would you like to accept Jesus and have access to his power to fix what's broken in your life? JJ did not have a seminary degree. JJ was a believer willing to allow God to use him to tell how God fixed his brokenness. That is an example of how a believer can allow the Holy Spirit within them to demonstrate the power of God. I don't know if Larry got saved. I made up the story, so yeah, we could say he did, but that's not the point. Maybe JJ was planting some seeds to get Larry thinking. Maybe in time, Larry accessed the power of God to change he and Mrs. the Mrs. way of relationship with each other. Regardless of the outcome, JJ was a good friend and a faithful servant of Jesus. He told the good news of how Jesus had helped him and Mrs. JJ fix what was broken in their marriage. Folks, all of you, what you come to church for, why I teach the Word of God, why your Sunday school teachers teach the Word of God, why the Bible study teachers teach the Word of God, is so that you can know God's design, so that you can live it and tell other people about it. That is it. That's why you come. Yes, we come to worship. Yes, we come to sing songs of praise. That's part of it too. But how you know what God's design is depends on you coming and allowing the Holy Spirit to tell you that. Rick Warren once wrote, "The way you store up treasure in heaven is by investing in people getting there. Your life as a Christian should make non-believers question their disbelief in God." How do we know what to say when we speak about spiritual things? We agree with Jesus to allow a demonstration of the Spirit's power through us. The essence of being a good and faithful servant to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is to agree with the Holy Spirit to demonstrate his power through us. And I'm going to tell you, folks, there's nothing like it. There's nothing greater on this earth. You may think there is, but there's nothing greater on this earth to let that power come through you and to see a life that is changed. You see, our job is not to make them drink. Our job is to let God through us make them thirsty. Then we tell the thirsty how to find the living water of Jesus Christ. Jesus said, "He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will be rivers of living water." Now that is a thirst quencher. You see, this is really good for my physical body. But the living water that Jesus teaches about, that takes care of the thirst of our spirit. Would you bow your heads with me? Gracious Heavenly Father, as we come to this time of making decisions, Lord, I prayed earlier, if there's somebody here that is watching, I pray, Father, that they will get saved today. Lord, through me, you have shared several different versions of how to be saved. So I pray, Father, for those that are not saved, that today you would demonstrate your power by giving them the courage to come to this altar or call on the phone lines and say, "Tell me how to be saved." Lord, there's some Christians here that have never allowed you to share the gospel through them in their entire walk with you. And Lord, I don't want them to feel guilty. I just want you to show them what they're missing. Lord, that's what we were created for. I know that. I get scared sometimes. I get nervous. But Lord, I have put my faith in your ability to do through me what you want, and no faith in my inability to do what I want. So Father, thy will be done on earth at this altar today, as it is in heaven, as we decide how you want us to respond to the message you preach through me. In Jesus' name, amen.